Welcome to DRGLT Economics. In this podcast, I want to discuss the demise of a US dollar-led global economic order. I want to discuss specifically its current circumstances, the conditions that would trigger this demise, and finally the aftermaths. A little bit more specifically, for the circumstances, I will discuss primarily the internal circumstances that have been created in the last 30 years. Three decades, actually a bit longer, but let's just say three decades. And I also want to highlight some of the external circumstances outside the control of the US government, or perhaps not strictly outside, but outside the direct control of them. And then as regards the conditions, I want to discuss a couple of possible triggers and one gradual way, gradual possible alternative or possibility that this will go down. And I think these events will take place within this decade. And finally, of course, I want to discuss the aftermaths, both in terms of the money, monetary policies around the world, global trade, investment, and of course also the living standards of various nations. So now let's begin from the first one. In the first one, as I said, I would discuss the internal and external circumstances that are setting up the scene for the demise of a US dollar-led global economic order. There are actually three main internal factors. The first one, I think, is the leading one. I'm far from the only person who has criticized it. And I'm also, as I say, I have actually criticized the US Federal Reserve on these policies and also the US government. On multiple occasions on this podcast. And that is the lowering of interest rate and money issuance, increasing money issuance. I said in the beginning of this podcast that these circumstances have been accumulating in the last three decades, and that number really corresponds with the continued reduction in interest rate and a continued increase in monetary supply. And this basically creates a scenario, of course, as I have repeatedly said, this is because the US, the United States runs the global reserve currency. They can export their inflation globally, let the rest of the world bear the consequences of inflation, while at the same time they themselves enjoy a standard of living that does not correspond with their level of productivity. This is the so-called exorbitant privilege, and they have been playing this card repeatedly in the last three decades. There is this, as I have mentioned multiple times, the Greenspan put, and lately, and then there was this quantitative easing, and now there is this transitory story, and everything points to the same thing, which is that it is much easier to print money and to pave over whatever social problem that you have in your society, to pave over whatever economic issue you have in your economy with money printing as well. As long as you can do it, it seems like a good solution. But that is creating a situation now where the interest rate is virtually zero. Monetary issuance is exceptionally high, and this is unstable. The second internal circumstance is really regards to the allocation of economic resources, of capital. Because of money printing, because of the Fed's reckless monetary policy, there has been an obvious misallocation of capital, of resources in the economy, not just in the United States, but actually globally. Globally, in the last three decades, we have seen almost uninterrupted, of course it was interrupted briefly in some markets, in some countries, but almost uninterrupted growth in real estate prices. And then we are also seeing that the shift in the investment mentality. There is no longer an emphasis on income, on dividends, right? But instead, emphasis has been on price. So you can see companies who are who basically don't have any profit, or has companies who have very little profit, or companies who are just cooking their books in order to look like they have a 1,000 times PE ratio. Doesn't matter. They can have very high market capitalization. Well, real companies who are who actually pay good dividends are dismissed by investors, by the capital market. And this basically leads us to number three, the third circumstance, which is that there is a huge imbalance in the society, where a few select rich people running the virtual economy, the Wall Street guys, the tech executives, they get paid a lot, they get to make a lot of money without having to pay any tax. Well, at the same time, because the interest rate is so low, so they borrow against their investment, so they never have to sell, they never have to pay any tax, right? That's the reason. Well, at the same time, the real economy, where people actually work to produce goods, where people actually provide real services, not those fake services like, for example, services not necessarily fake, but services that actually detract from productivity, such as Facebook, for example. In the real economy, people are doing worse and worse, so there is this gigantic imbalance. So these are the internal circumstances, right? Interest rate has been so low, cannot be lower. Money issuance is so high, the credibility of the US dollar is being threatened. The real estate bubble is so big that people can hardly afford it if the interest rate is not at zero. Well, at the same time, all the money has been allocated to the virtual economy, where the real economy have been underinvested, and people are basically, the majority of people who are basically rely on employment in the real economy, they're suffering. So that's the internal situation. And externally, of course, we know that the US dollar has always been reliant on the so-called petrodollar, and the United States government has never been shy to wage wars, of course, bearing the flag of democracy, freedom, and the other type of propagandist slogans, in order to enforce their grip on this global commodities trade. But currently, we have this external circumstance, which is that the United States, along with its select allies, have practically alienated almost all the what would be called the third world countries, right? People not in America's allied list. These are the specific countries which they rely on for resources, for manufactured goods, and in a lot of times also for labor. So this creates, and of course those countries, they sell to the United States resources and manufactured goods, and because they have to pay in US dollar, when they have this US dollar, they circulate the US dollar back to the Wall Street. They invest in a lot of the US equities and of course US bonds, and this is essentially what has been a laundering machine of kind, whereby just by the magic of Wall Street and the reserve currency status, the United States is able to take a cut of the world's global commodities trade, of all the global trade, and so this has allowed the United States to live far beyond its means. But because the circumstances is such that it has antagonized most of the countries that are providing these resources and manufactured goods, going forward, it is possible. In fact, in my view, it is absolutely going to happen, inevitable, that these countries would at some point cut themselves off a system that is untrustworthy, unreliable, and draconian. And this, I think, is a good point for us to go to the second part of today's podcast, which is about the conditions of the demise of US dollar led economic order. There are three, I think. Two of them are triggers, right? The first trigger, which it just may happen this year, but I think it's not. I think maybe next year. Maybe next year and probably 2024, it's possible. Which is, if Russia cuts itself off from the SWIFT system and insists that all goods that Russia sells must be paid in other currencies, no settlement is to be done in the US dollar. Now, this is a very interesting point, and it's a point that is very ironic. You see, today, and I'm making today's podcast, at the end of February 2022, which is just right after, I think, less than 2 days after Russia started this their military operation in Ukraine. And this is also a point when the British media and the American media have been criticizing their allies, quote-unquote allies, for not going along with cutting Russia off the SWIFT system. Now, this of course is a mirage. The real reason is that the United States cannot afford to have Russia cut off the SWIFT system. And the reason is very simple. You see, Russia sells in a significant amount its energies and other type of resources to Europe, which is America's major ally, the most important ally, a group of allies. As I have mentioned, basically vassal states. The problem is that the reliance of European economies on Russian resources is almost absolute. There is, the reliance may not be absolute, It is absolutely impossible for Europe to continue to have a functional economy without Russian resources. And so if Russia is to be cut off the SWIFT system, what they have to do, would they say, okay, we use a different system. We will accept euros in payment. And then what happens is that the US dollar will not be used by the European Union, a lot of these European countries, to conduct trade with the Russians. And of course, we know that Russians have a lot of friends who are in similar positions. They may not be as strong, and they may not stand up against the US hegemony by themselves, but they may also prefer at this point that at least part of their trades be done with other currencies that make more sense, instead of having every trade, bilateral trade, between countries that do not have the US dollar as their own currency, to settle everything in US dollar. That is not necessarily the most efficient way to, in fact, it is not the most efficient way to settle trades. So they may go ahead and make this demand, and thereby the reserve status of the US dollar will be further challenged. And this, together with the internal problems that I have laid out, basically it will actually exacerbate all of those problems, because those problems have taken so long to manifest because the US dollar has been the global reserve currency, because they have been able to live off of that status. If that status is threatened, it doesn't have to be completely removed. If it's threatened, what's going to happen is that within the US dollar, United States, there's going to be, let's go to the consequences next. So let me go to that later. So let me just suffice to say that this is one of the trigger possible. And the second trigger, it's a weaker one, but it may just happen, which is that if Saudi Arabia and OPEC in general decide that they will be happy to sell oil in not just the US dollar, but maybe one other currency or maybe two. And this would again have the similar effect. And I think at that point, Russia would also insist on getting paid by some other currencies, in rubles or in euros or whatever currency, but not the US dollar. And that, again, is going to be devastating for the United States and also, and its European vassals. So that's the second trigger. And of course, if neither of the above takes place, what's going to happen is still that because of the internal problems that I have laid out in the beginning of this podcast, there will have to be adjustments. There will have to be adjustments that I will discuss, in fact, in the consequences, the aftermath of the demise of the economic order. But really, it's part of it. Part of the demise is the process, because it's not one day that USD gets canceled, right? Canceled out of social media, like there's tech people who just disappear people like KGB units or whatever. That's not how it's going to happen, but it's going to be gradual. And the entire process is really underpinned by the fact that with a real economy that has been severely weakened, and in the case of many Western European countries, the entire countries are deindustrialized and entirely reliant on the virtual economy. When the the entire paradigm shifts, these countries will suffer, will gradually suffer more and more. It's not stagnation, but it's continued fall in living standards, and dramatic fall in living standards. And this will, of course, make it cost them the credibility, and it's not going to be pretty for them. So now let's go to the aftermath. And the aftermath basically is going to be, in my opinion, on the global stage, we're going to see in our investment front, there's going to be a gradual but a steady mindset, shift of mindset. And this is a paradigm shift. What I predict will happen is that interest rates will have to rise, and the countries cannot, as the United States gradually loses its grip on the global economy, on its reserve status of their currency, they will have to print less. Maybe in the very short term they can print more, but that just only accelerates the situation. Eventually, they will no longer be able to print money to solve problems, and the interest rate will have to rise. With a rising interest rate, real estate prices globally, I think, will fall. It will fall significantly, and in some cases, when an economy that has been deindustrialized and solely reliant on virtual economy, and I'm thinking about Britain, the real estate prices can fall quite a lot. And then we can see, I think, in my opinion, a complete reallocation of capitals away from the virtual economy, away from the likes of Facebook, of Tesla, for example. And it was so ridiculous, just think about Tesla. Just a few months ago, Tesla, a company that makes unreliable cars with shoddy quality, a car, and it does not even sell that many of them, has a market capitalization practically the equivalent of all the rest major automakers in the world combined. This is so ridiculous. This company, the reason you see this company wants to promote this so-called quote-unquote AI and quote-unquote self-driving technologies is, in my opinion, solely to hide the fact, to plaster over the fact that what they're selling is only just as complex as those radio-controlled cars that you buy kids of 3 years plus. That's basically what it is, a battery and an electric motor. That's basically what it is. And they have to make sure that there are some slogans and marketing gimmicks thrown in, which is self-driving and AI. But the fact is, in my opinion at least, if you don't know how to drive, don't drive. And if you need to rely on the computer to drive, don't, because computer AI programs, no matter how great they are no substitute for yourself when it comes to events with severe consequences. That's as far as all I want to say, because it's already a digression. I'm sorry that I digress there. Another, there's going to be emphasis away from this type of companies that are just all marketing, very little income, to real companies that are generating income. And I think, in fact, with this shift, the price of labor will go up. I think the position of labor actually will be better. And this will be a complete reversal of what has happened in the last 3-4 decades. And I think that is going to be a good thing. So that's when it comes to money and investment. Now, what about global trade? What is going to happen? Well, there are so many different solutions. I don't know exactly what is going to happen, so I'm not going to talk about that. But what I'm going to say, another point, I'm going to touch on the final point, in fact, is a severe consequence for the United States and for its European allies. For the United States, the impact is direct, because as they lose the reserve status, the United States will no longer enjoy the privilege that has been conferred by this status. So they will no longer be able to live beyond their means. And in fact, they may have to pay back at least some of their debts. And there are a lot of debts. They have borrowed a lot of money. So if the US becomes weakened, it loses its reserve currency status, gradually, over time, its military will no longer receive the amount of ridiculous funding that it does today, and some of its debtors may come on America's doorsteps and say, you see, we need to get paid, and that is going to basically mean that over the medium term, I think there is going to be a sharp decline in the living standards in the United States. And that could, at worst, be as bad as that of the Soviet Union in the 1990s. It could just happen. But it's not necessarily going to happen so dramatically. So, right, I don't want to dramatize these things. And then when it comes to America's allies, their so-called allies, because they also partake, and I'm talking about their European allies, because while America also has strong allies, quote-unquote strong allies in Japan and South Korea, those are two industrialized, prosperous, maybe not so prosperous in the case of Japan, maybe stagnant, but still industrialized economies with a strong technological base and somewhat independent monetary policy. That would allow them to actually benefit from this from this paradigm shift. In fact, I think with this paradigm shift, Japan could see a real revitalization of their economy. Because even though they have suffered a lot, they have suffered a lot in the last three decades, I think because it still is a strong manufacturing economy, and because it still provides some of the best goods in their respective categories that are in high demand across the world, I think Japan would benefit. I think South Korea would benefit. But the same cannot be said about Europe, because Europe is, perhaps with the exception of Germany, deindustrialized. I think maybe the exception, let's say also Italy, because Italy, northern Italy at least, it is still industrialized. In France, in Belgium, in the UK, you know, I know the UK is no longer part of the European Union, but in these countries, they are mostly deindustrialized. And they rely on their service economy. Part of that is really because they are the vassal states of the United States, and the United States give them some crumbs to service. And when that goes away, the viability of the European economy can be in serious question. And the final note, I want to discuss, in fact, I think in the next podcast, Europe's worsening energy crisis. With this problem, with the cancellation of Nord Stream 2, which is by no means, let's understate this. This is very important cancellation. And this is basically, to give a metaphor, I think it's basically the Europeans tying up the snooze on their own neck, right? And they can tip over at any moment, and at which point their industries will be destroyed, the remnants of which, and they will become a deindustrialized region that is not really at the center of global trade, with a former owner or whatever, boss, ally, let's say, that is no longer dominant. They will have difficulty finding their way back. Europe can, whereas the United States, I think, eventually will recover, because it's still a country with a lot of talented people, strong technological base, still industrialized, and a lot of resources, and quite good geography, because for the security that it provides. So it will rebound. Europe, on the other hand, can really experience what happened to the Soviet Union in the 1990s. And it could be very difficult for the Euro, for the European economy to really rebound, because they lack the competitive advantage at that point. And so that, I think, is the extent that I want to discuss it in today's podcast. To recap, I think that there are a range of internal circumstances and some external circumstances that make the decline, the end of US dollar-led economic order almost inevitable. And there are some triggers that can hasten this process. But even without these triggers taking place, I think within this decade, the US dollar will no longer be the reserve currency, and the consequences will be severe for the Europeans the most, and the Americans second, ironically. Of course, if you find some of the points interesting, some of the point that I've discussed in today's podcast interesting, please give it a thumbs up, share it, like it, subscribe to my channel if you so desire. And in the next podcast, I promise I will discuss the worsening energy crisis in the European Union. I think this is going to be really disastrous for European competitiveness, for European industries, and with the demise of US dollar, even their virtual economy will no longer be here, and I don't know what else will be. All right, thanks for listening, and I wish you a very good day.